So I want to thank God for all of our listeners and our viewers, and we want to always be grateful of your and thankful of your giving, your support of this ministry. We want to thank you for listening. We want to thank you for not only just listening, but meditating and sharing this word with others. There are many people who are not members of this congregation who are excited about the word of God that's going forth here, and they're excited about what God is doing in your life. So a lot of times they can't see me, but they can see you, they can hear you. And as you continue to allow the Spirit of God to grow your Holy Ghost, or should I say to grow your spirit, man, and you bubble over and you just talk to them and you tell them and you're excited about what God is doing, they are sensing and they are realizing that God is real. He is faithful. He is truthful. He's a restorer. He's a deliverer. He's all of those things that he said he is and some. And so we just need to keep on keeping on and keep on demonstrating the word of God and walking in his will. I want to want you to continue to pray for those who have lost loved ones. I want you to continue to pray for Deacon James as he's eulogizing his sister in Florida. Should I say he's attending there? And wanted you to pray for Sister Lisa Blow, who lost her dad, her father, on last week. Thank God for Deacon Lee being at home now, and God is continuing to heal his body and make him stronger. And pray for all of these spouses of these individuals who are sick or moving on toward healing, and those who have lost loved ones. We want to pray for their families, in particular the spouses, that they may be strong. And we want to thank God for the saints. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your love and kindness. Thank you for your giving and all that you do in this family to make sure that when one hurts, everybody hurts. So we just bless God for that. I want to talk to you today about the fact that God is a jealous God. The God that we serve, Almighty God, Creator King, is a jealous God. We're going to be coming out of Exodus chapter 20. I'm going to be in the Living Bible, verse 1 through 5, and then we'll be moving back and forth. But I want you to remember and understand that God is a jealous God. He says it in his word that he is a jealous God. And sometimes we ask ourselves, why is he jealous? Why is God a jealous God? Why does he say that? And I'm talking about he's the type of jealous God that he doesn't want anybody or anything before him. Hallelujah. He's a jealous God. He's a selfish God. He's a God that he don't want to share and will not share his glory, his fame, his majesty with anybody. And I love the fact that God is that way because he keeps his end of the bargain. God is the type of God, he's like a husband who has, because you understand that the church is the bride and he's the bridegroom. God is like a husband who works every day, all day long. And he works to provide for his family. Particularly, we're talking about his wife. He works to provide for his wife. He works to make sure that she has everything that she needs, that she wants for nothing, and that she lives the best, that she dresses the best, and she is accommodated by the best. And there's nothing that he withholds from her. And he sacrifices every day. He goes to work. And he goes to work when he's tired. He goes to work when he's kind of sick. He goes to work whether he feel like it or not because he loves his wife and he does not mind sacrificing for her. And so he gives his all. He gives everything that he has for her. And that's how God is. And this particular husband is dedicated. He's faithful. He's loyal to his wife. He's committed to her. There's nothing that she needs he won't do. And in the time of stress and in the time of trouble, he's there even to talk to her and to comfort her and to build her back up and to have her restored so that she may continue to move on and live in victory and live in comfort and live in abundance. And so this man comes home one day, this husband comes home one day, and he goes in his house and he finds his loving wife in the bedroom in the arms of another man. Somebody gonna pray with me. And all of a sudden he becomes jealous and outrageous. That's the kind of God we serve. God will not be satisfied because he has delivered us, he has kept us, he has saved us, he has restored us, he's brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light. He has shed his blood, he allowed his son Jesus to go to the cross and shed his blood for us. And he's done all of this so that we can live and live and have life and have it more abundantly. Every time we need him, he shows up. He might not come when we want him, but he's always on time. He prepares for us a place not only here, but in the hereafter. And God is just a God who loves us and he takes good care of us. But when we do wrong and we put something or somebody else before him, God is a jealous God. And so we must understand that he has a right to be jealous after all that he's done for me and after all he's done for you. He has a right. He has a right. And so Exodus chapter 20, verse 1 says, then God issued this edict. He says, I am Jehovah your God. And he's talking to the children of Israel. He says, who liberated you from your slavery in Egypt? You remember God said, according to, and he's talking about he delivered Egypt. I mean, he delivered Israel out of Egypt. Delivered them out of depression. Delivered them out of the hands of the Egyptians, those that beat them and whipped them and took food from them and oppressed them and treated them unfair. He delivered his people out of the hands of the Egyptians. And as we look at it today, Ephesians in chapter 2 says, and you, and talking about us, he made us alive when you were dead, slain by your trespasses and sins. And so in sense, God is saying, since I brought you out of darkness and saved and delivered you, since I had my only begotten son to die for your sins, and I gave you back your right mind and I restored your soul, you may worship no other God than me. When we look at the word worship, we understand worship means love, reverence, give devotion to, pray to, give respect to, adore. He says, you are to love no other God before me. You are not to reverence any other God. You are not to give devotion to or pray to or give respect to no other God than me, because God is a jealous God. And don't fool yourself. The reason why society is in trouble now is because they've just done it. They've put everything before the God that has kept them and saved them and delivered them. And God says, I'm not going to continue to stand for that. I told you. See, here's the deal. God knew. Just based on what Adam and Eve, the decision Adam and Eve made in the garden, God knew that Israel was going to be up and down. He knew that as soon as he delivered them and made them free, that they were going to act up. And so you have to be careful. You have to be careful when God delivers you. You have to be careful to make sure that you're in the right mindset when God delivers you. Because if you're not careful, you will thank God for a few minutes that he has delivered you and kept you. And then you'll celebrate and go ahead and forget about God and start worshiping the creation and the things that God created rather than the creator. See, God knew that Israel was the type of folk that if he didn't tell them ahead of time, he said, look here, when I deliver you and you go into the land of promise He said, I need you to be careful. First of all, I need you to make sure that you don't serve any other God, that you don't worship any God. And I want to let you know, God said, I'm telling you up front that I am a jealous God. I am not going to deliver you out of Egypt. I'm not going to deliver you out of bondage and allow you to go into a place and be free and then do what you want to do. I can't get no help. But I don't need no help, because you got to understand that freedom, when you're free to do something, somebody paid the price. Oh, we might be free in Christ Jesus, but somebody, Jesus, paid the price for us to be free in Him. And God is not going to sit idly by and let us do what we want to do and not hold us accountable for living right and putting other things and other gods before Him. God says, I want your love. I want your first love. I want to be your first love. I want to be reverence. I want you to be devoted to me. I want when you pray that you pray to me. When you respect anybody, I don't want you to give them more respect and more authority and more problem stance. I don't want you to praise them more than you praise me. I'm a jealous God. Where were they when I delivered you? Where were they when you were out of your mind? Where were they when your body needed healing? Where were they when you didn't have money in your pocket? And you got the nerve to serve them and push me to the side. God is a jealous God. He's a jealous God. He's a jealous God. He's a jealous God. He's a jealous God. Nothing in this world should have nothing else in this world should have possession of you, possession of your support, your loyalty, possession of your dedication, and possession of your commitment more than me. That's what God say. God said, I want all of you. After all, I sent my son. I didn't send half of my son. I sent all of my son. He didn't die halfway. He didn't quit. He didn't abort the mission. He died all the way. He died for all of us sin. He shedded his blood so that I might live. And he didn't save me halfway from hell. He saved us all the way from hell. So he says in verse 4, he says, you shall not make yourself any idols, no images of animals, birds, or fish. Now, where did they get this idea from? You have to understand that when the Egyptians were over, when the Israelites, the Hebrew children were over in Egypt, they were depressed and oppressed, and they saw a lot of things. They saw a lot of things. They saw how the Egyptians worshiped their gods. They saw what kind of gods they worshiped. They saw, you know, they were made out of wood and gold and silver. They were made out of things that were made by the hands of man. And they looked and they saw how well the Egyptians ate. They saw how prosperous they were. I'm going somewhere with this. They saw how the economy was. They saw that the Egyptians had anything they wanted. They were a powerful nation. They were powerful military-wise. They were powerful in their economics. They were powerful in their science. They were powerful in their commerce. They were powerful in their ability to architect. They were the highest in technology back in those days. A lot of things came from them when it comes to the reading and the language and just a whole lot of things that develop into what we now know in America to be that helps society. They were just going and blowing, man. And so the Hebrew slaves being in slavery, they saw all of this stuff. And see, when you're in slavery and you don't know God and have a God, and you don't know which way to turn, what you see your oppressor having and living like, that's what you aspire to be and have. But you have to be careful with that, because that eventually, if you're not careful, will become your God. And so they aspired to have and to when to have everything that the Egyptians had. And so the first thing, and see, they're molded to this. You know, they see, oh, that's what I'd like. Oh, one day I could have that. One day I could worship like that. One day I could be successful that way. And so when they got delivered, when God delivered them from Egypt and he put them out in the wilderness, God understood that that kind of thinking, that kind of aspiration, those kind of dreams was going to destroy them. So he put them in the wilderness and he gives them law so that they can get all of that stuff, all of that worldliness, all that worldly stuff, all of that Egyptian ology out of them, and that he could put his word in them and that he could put his commandments in them so that they would be able to prosper and they would be able to serve him and continue from generation to generation to prosper in him, to grow in him, and to build his kingdom on this earth. God knew that. But he also knew that, and so that's why he gave the commandments, and that's why he taught them and told them all the things that they should do. And he says, I'm a jealous God, and you should have no God before me. Because he knew that as soon as they got free, as soon as they got delivered, the first thing they was going to do is try to be like all of them folk back there in Egypt. We as Christians have to be careful when God deliver us. We as saints of the living God and believers have to be careful that when God hear our prayer and he answers our prayer and he comes in and deliver us from the oppression or oppression and he causes us to get out of problems and situations and all of this trouble, we have to be careful what we aspire to be and aspire to do in those situations. Because if you're not careful when we are set free from oppression, when we are set free and we are now coming together and we're unified and all these things are working for us, if we are not careful, we'll forget the God that brought us out of all of those things and we'll start worshiping stuff that God said you are not to worship. We'll start giving our affection and our love and we'll start being committed to things that God is trying to tell us, you can't put that before me because that's not what delivered you and got you here. I need somebody to track with me. I need somebody to understand that you can't use your freedom and your liberty as for an occasion to sin and to fulfill this flesh. You better make sure, because God is still saying, and that's what got you in the place, that's what got us into trouble in the first place, that's what got these United States in trouble in the first place, is that God is a jealous God and we're putting other things before him. And it is amazing how the cycle, if you want to know how people do and how societies do, just look at Israel. Up and down. They sin, God punish them. They cry out to God and pray, God deliver them. They live right for a little while. They get happy. They get free. They get excited. And they start sinning all over again. And God comes and first he sent the prophet. And they don't like the prophet. They don't like the preacher. They stone the preacher or the prophet, lock him up, run him out of town. Or cut his head off. You know, they don't want to hear none of that. So God always sends a warning before he sends destruction. And so what he does, so the people, they don't want to hear what's right. They don't want to hear truth. And so God says, okay, if they won't listen to the prophet, then I'm going to have to allow some stuff to come against them again. And so there they go. You know, and they got all these problems and issues. And so they crying out to God. Because you got to understand that the children of Israel, the Hebrew kids, children, were over in Egypt, man, for 400 years. 400 years. Praise. And stuff. And you know, our forefathers been praying. And we've been praying. And we got to see, the problem is those of us who are righteous and God has saved and kept us, we got to be steadfast. We got to persevere. We can't go back into the world. And then when God blesses us, we got to make sure that we give God the glory and the honor and we thank him and praise him. How do you thank God and praise him? Not just by lifting your hands and opening your mouth. You thank him by living right. You thank him and you praise him by doing what he called us to do. We thank him and praise him by being salt, by walking in truth, by walking upright, by living what he said, living how he says we ought to live. We must understand that you must never bow down. God said, he said, you must never bow down and worship anything in any way Why? For I, the Lord your God, am very possessive. God said, I'm possessive. God says, I'm nobody's fool. God says, you're not going to use me. I'm not going to save you, deliver you, restore you, and then you're going to say, thank you very much, see you later. And when you get in trouble, oh, Lord God, please come help me. And expect for him to run. God says, I'm not a bellhop. You can't ring a bell and I show up and you do what you want to do all of the time. You're not going to do what you want to do. Live like you want to live. Go where you want to go. Be who you want to be and not be committed and leave me out. And all of a sudden you're going to call on me and I'm going to show up and deliver you like I did last time. You better check yourself and understand that our God is a jealous God. God said, I'm a jealous God. I'm jealous. You're not going to fool around on me. You're not going to do what you want to do and still receive my grace and my love and my mercy and my love and kindness for you. You better watch out. It's going to run out. It's going to run out. I know your fleshly mind and your ways you've been used to having your way. I know you've been used to having your way. But God says, you're not going to have your way. And he's talking to Christian folks, too. He's talking to his people. You know, he said, you're not going to have your way. He said, you're going to honor me one way or the other. Mm-hmm. Some people think knees going to bow and every tongue going to confess that he's Lord in that day. No, 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 no. God is reckoning it. And his oh, my God, his recompense. And his rewards is coming now, and it's coming early, and it's coming sooner than later. I can remember times, even in my short 5 decades of being here, I can remember God taking a long time. I can remember God taking a long time to do some things and to correct some things. Mm-hmm. But these last 5 to 10 years, I've seen God just if you just be still and know that God. If you just hold on to what you got, if you just take a stand and be firm and gird up the loins of your mind and put on the full armor of God and stand and do all you can to do and stand, and if you persevere and let his staying power rule in you, if you walk in truth, if you hold on to what God has given you, if you stay with God and hold on to his unchanging hand, all you need to do is understand that he will come through, that you will be an overcomer, that he will perfect that which concerns you. Just stay, just all you have to do is stay with him and watch him work, because he's always able to deliver you. Always. Just because he don't deliver you when you ask him doesn't mean that he cannot. Why? Because he's preparing. Mm-hmm. He's conditioning. He's developing. He's thoroughly doing something in you that you missed. He does it. When God matures you and builds you up and grow you, and grow us, he does a thorough job. Mm-hmm. That's why he lets sometimes various trials and tribulations, different ones. This trial over here will correct this in you, but it won't correct that in you. So he sent another type that will come against you to correct this in you, because he wants you to be whole here and there and here and here and here. And as you unify in your wholeness, and as you grow in your wholeness and become a total and complete man and a mature man, not only can God use you, but you'll have a victorious life. You'll be walking around and looking and saying, oh, my God, I never thought I'd be like this at this age. I never thought I'd have this at this age. Out of all I've been through, and I still got a good mind, after all I've been through, I still have joy. Unspeakable and full of glory. After all the enemy has done against me, I'm still coming out like pure gold. After all that's come against me, I still lift my hands and say, Lord, I love you, I praise you, I adore you, I glorify you, I magnify you, I exalt you. You are my God and I am your child. Lord, thank you. Lord, you are awesome. Lord, you are worthy. Lord, you are my everything. Woo. So you must never bow or worship anything, because I'm a possessive God. God says I'm very selfish. I'm domineering. I'm jealous. I'm controlling and overprotective. Y'all didn't know God was like that, did you? Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, he is. He said, I will not share your affection with any other God. What is he saying? He says, I will not share your fondness, your adoration, your passion, your feelings, or likings with any other God. So if you're living a life to where you have more fondness and adoration and passion and affection for others, more so than God, God says, no, I'm jealous. And he said, God says this, he says, look, I'm going to punish you for that. I'm not going to let you get away with it. And he says, and when I punish people for their sins, the punishment continues upon the children, the grandchildren, and the great-grandchildren of those who hate me. So if you think you're just going to do what you want to do, see, a lot of time because we're not getting stoned and we're not, people are not casting us out of the city and, you know, putting us in exile, we feel like we're getting away with it. See, don't ever tell yourself because judgment is not falling. It doesn't seem like anything is being done about what you're doing against God, that it's okay. Don't fool yourself. You think it's okay, but God got a record keeper. He got a record holder. He has a bookkeeper that's writing it all down. He writing it all down, and it's getting more and more and more and more, and after a while, you're going to fill up your sin. Your allotment for sin is going to be full, and then judgment fall. And see, people don't understand that. They want to do anything they want to do and all they want to do, and they really don't want to hear the prophet and the preacher, and they want to do all of this stuff, and then when judgment fall, they want everybody to pray for them. But here's the deal. When people pray for you, they have to have the heart of God and the faith of God to believe that when they pray that God is going to deliver you, okay, because they're praying. But in that situation, God won't even allow folk to pray for you. And then when they pray, it won't even go nowhere. It just hit the... God said, I've been talking to them for a long time. God said, I've been trying to get their attention for a long time. God says, I use a child to try to get their attention. I use a little small circumstances over here to try to get their attention. I've tried so many times to get them to turn around. I've tried to get them to stop loving that. I've made that sour in their psychological taste so that they won't want it anymore. I have prevented it to be sour and displeasing to them, and they find a way to go back to it. They find a way to change, to continue to like it and do what they've been doing. He said, I've got mothers and fathers, particularly dads, that keep doing stuff, and I've pleaded with them, I've showed them my word, I've given them my word, I've told them through their friends, I've told them through families, I've told them through co-workers, I've told them all of these things, and they continue to still do what they want to do. He says, I tell you what, I'm going to visit your children, and I'm going to visit your children's children, and your children's children's children. You look at some families and you wonder why they always got something going on. From great granddad all the way down to the baby got something going on all the time. That's why God says, I'm going to punish the children, the grandchildren, and the great grandchildren of those who hate me. He says, but I lavish my love upon thousands. Look at that. But the flip side of the coin is those that love me, the uncompromising righteous, look what he does. He lavishes his love upon a thousand of those who love me and obey my commandments. Psalm 78, now we're going straight to the Amplifier, 78:58. Psalm 78:58, for they provoked him to righteous anger. How much time we got? He said, for they provoked him to righteous anger, all right, with their high places for idol worship and move him to jealousy with their graven image. Okay, that's what they said. He said, see, you have to understand that when God gets provoked and he decided to do some things, he's righteous in what he does. God is righteous in his judgment. Okay? He's righteous in his anger. He's righteous. He says, I have righteous anger with their high places for idol worship and moved him to jealousy with their graven images. Deuteronomy 4, 23 and 24 says, he says, so watch yourselves. And see, this is what I was saying earlier. When God has blessed you and he's delivered you, and he keeps being faithful and committed and dedicated and devoted to us, to you. He says in verse 23 of Deuteronomy, he says, so watch yourself that you do not forget the covenant of the Lord your God, which he made with you. God, see, people don't understand about our relationship with God. We are in covenant relationship. We're in a contractual agreement with God. God sent his son to die for us and save us. That's his agreement. That's his half. But our half is that we got to call him. We got to serve him. He has to be Lord. We got to make him Lord of our life. We got to obey him. We got to do what he tells us to do. Since he saved us and delivered us, our part of the agreement is that we have to do and obey what he tells us to do. He says, for the Lord your God is a consuming fire, a jealous God. So God is a consuming fire. God has a way. He says, look, and make yourself the... Let me just back up. So watch yourselves that you do not forget the covenant of the Lord your God, which he made with you, and make yourselves a graven image in the form of anything against which the Lord your God has commanded you. For the Lord your God is a consuming fire, a jealous God. And so Deuteronomy 6:15 says, for the Lord your God in the midst of you is a jealous God. Otherwise, the anger of the Lord your God will be kindled against you, and he will wipe you off the face of the earth. Amen. Deuteronomy 32:16 says this, they made him jealous with strange gods. I want to know how God views a powerful nation like the United States of America. I wonder if God is jealous because he's blessed us so much and yet we've turned from him. I'm noticing that we are still, and that's why you have to continue to pray. I'm noticing that laws are getting passed in states that are totally against the word and the will of God. Do you understand what I'm saying? God didn't set us free so that we can make up our own laws and continue to disobey him. Amen. And so he says they made him jealous with strange gods, with abominations. They provoked what? Him to anger. I have one more for you. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 through 20. He says, do you not know? We know this scripture. He said, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? The Holy Spirit is on the inside of you, but he's inside of your body, and your body is just not anything. Your body is just not there for just to hold the Spirit of God, just an empty shell, just a vacancy. He says, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own. For you have been bought with a price. He said, therefore, the fact that you've been bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body. What is he saying? Glorify God in your body. He says, give God praise and adoration in your body. Mm-hmm. Open your mouth to sing his praise, but also speak his word. When you open your mouth to give God praise, you need to also be speaking the word of God. He says, glorify and praise God in your body. He says, lift your hands to worship him, but also take them same hands and work for him. Hallelujah. He's saying, move your feet to dance for him, but make sure you walk upright as you travel in this earth. Use your mind to think of his mercy and his love and kindness and his compassion toward you, which are new every morning. Make sure you permit your inner man to commune with God and allow his Holy Spirit to reign, to take over your life. That's what we need to do. We need to have such a connection and a relationship with God that we would allow the Holy Spirit on the inside of us to reign, to reign, to rule. Let him reign. What are we saying? Let him take over. Let him take over your life. You stop taking over and let the Holy Ghost take over. Take over your livelihood. And then you need to remember this. I've said this before. I think it was probably a week ago. Luke 1:37. You don't have to serve other gods and worship other gods and give your affection and your love and your commitment to anything or anybody else. Well, I need to have a little fun. You don't know what fun is until you've committed your life to Christ. You don't know what fun is until you have committed and dedicated and become faithful to the Lord your God. You don't know what fun is. You don't know what happiness and joy is. And so we must understand that after we've been through all of this stuff and we realize, the Bible says, for with God, nothing is ever impossible. Nothing is ever impossible. Feels impossible. Looks impossible. But you must understand that nothing is ever impossible. And no word from God, when God speaks his word, it says no word from God will be without power or impossible or fulfillment. I need you to understand, and I'm going to close with this. Every now and then, God will give me the gift of faith. I have faith, but he gives me the gift of faith. That means there's a power that comes upon me. And no matter what I'm facing or people are facing or the world is facing, I don't turn to the right or to the left. I feel peaceful, even though I should be anxious. But there's a peace that surpasses all understanding that stays within me, and it steadies me and it holds me, and I'm able to stand. And then in leadership, people always listen to what you say and they watch what you do. So there's a certain amount of pressure that's on you. But I need you to understand that last Sunday evening, a peace came upon me and I was peaceful. And I had no anxiety, no worries, and nothing all day Monday. And sometimes, because I'm a musician, sometimes I get into the music room and I put on the headphones so I don't bother anybody else in the house, and I throw myself a concert. Mm-hmm. I get in there and I play all the songs I want to. I had a beat going, I had an organ sound as loud as I wanted, and I throw myself a concert. And I was just in there just having a good time, just having my own service. And there's a song that came up. And the song said, I know the Lord will make a way. Amen. This was Monday evening. The song says, I know the Lord will make a way. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. He will lead you. He says, he'll make a way for you. He will lead you safely through. I know the Lord will make a way. And so, as election day came through and came into fruition, people were voting. And I must admit that I didn't sleep real well Tuesday night. But I remember, I know the Lord will make a way. Yes, he will. And that stayed with me. And then sometimes I couldn't even remember the song. I just knew I sung it Monday night, and it stayed in my spirit. And as I began to persevere and rest in the Lord and began to watch numbers and listen to different things. And, you know, as you listen to the news, your spirit be up and down. Your spirit be, you know, you'll be hopeful, and then you'll be like, well, we need to pray, we need to pray, we need to pray. And so, and then this message came late Friday night. This message I'm preaching today. And so when I woke up Saturday, and First Lady came back to the bathroom, she was just so excited. I knew what was going on then. I said, something happened. And so when everything was counted in the results, and my mind went back to, I know the Lord will make a way. Yes, He will. God always honors His word. God always, forever will always honor His word. We just need to live right, do right. Believe Him, take a stand, and understand that justice and truth and the word of God will always prevail. Keep praying, keep loving, keep perseverance, and be steadfast. And remember, God is a jealous God, and He's not going to have any other God before Him. God bless you. We'll see you again.